Here's the rundown of some of the best in the city scene this week. We sample Pinoy food in all shapes and sizes and reminisce old Manila. Then we take a sneak peek into a Bicolano epic and a play on national treasures. The countdown starts now, so get ready as we explore the cityscape. Hi guys, I'm Primella Veranda, your guide to the urban jungle, and we're giving you a lowdown of the best in the metro. It's all about Pinoy pride as we celebrate the anniversary of the EDSA Revolution, starting with great Pinoy talents showcasing their craft in theater. Bart Gingona and Joaquin Valdez star in the adaptation of the award-winning play, Red. Melissa G. reports.
Tony Award-winning play Red makes its Asian debut right here in Manila. And if you're a fan of the arts, this is something that is not to be missed. Red tells the story of Mark Rothko, a famous painter in the 50s, who was commissioned to paint a group of murals for the Four Seasons restaurant. But at the last minute, he decides to keep the paintings and returns the payment. In the play, Rothko is joined by his fictional assistant, Ken, who questions his theories on art and the particular commission.
It's really the story of someone who is so pure about his art that he almost does not have a place in the real world, you know. It's very hard nowadays to find people who are pure about their pursuit of anything. Everything is pwede na, or everything is fine, okay lang. Everything is passing, so people don't experience life intensely and fully. And this play shows us what we're missing. Sometimes in the rush of daily life, we forget that that life should be grabbed with full gusto and intensity, and it's sometimes nice to be reminded that the intensity of life is what makes it special. So you know, hindi okay lang. It's got to be superlative.
Bart Gingona brings Mark Rothko to life in this production, as well as directing it, while Joaquin Valdez joins him on stage as Ken.
Reality, the late 50s was when Rothko was commissioned to do the Seagram murals. He was alone. He was alone in his New York studio. And at the end of that era, he called the one that commissioned him to do the murals and said, "I'm going to give back the money. I don't want to give my paintings to you guys." So the play is an attempt to understand what could have been his process and what actually led him to decide that he's not going to give out his paintings anymore. There was a lot of discussion of, was he selling out? Did Manhattan beat Rothko? Did commercialism consume him? Was he feeling guilty? That's why he pulled out of the commission. So enter John Logan, the playwright, and in the personification of all of us trying to understand Rothko, he put it in this fictional assistant named Ken. And basically, Ken is a foil. Revealing to all of us, the audience, and to Ken, the kind of man that Rothko is. And he's inquisitive, he's critical, he is persistent, he's determined, he's not necessarily anti-Rothko, but he questions Rothko a lot. And that's essentially what the audience will be doing, questioning Rothko in this process. So it's a nice device that John Logan, the playwright, did and used to expose what could have been his process as an artist.
Van Gogh, the misunderstood martyr. You insult these men by reducing them to your own adolescent stereotypes.
There's a line in the play when he says, black is the opposite of red, not in the spectrum, but in reality. Because red is the symbol for life. It is the most vibrant color. And black is the absence of any color. So it talks about passion. It talks about life. Talks about the need to, you know, to for art to move you to some kind of emotional commitment.
Red showcases not only the huge talent of these two actors, but the gifted students of the College of St. Benilde School of Design and Art as well, who are mounting the play alongside Actors Actors Incorporated.
More Pinoy Pride after the break. A Bicolano epic takes center stage, and Floy Quintas shows our country's treasures in a different light. All that and more when Cityscape returns. Welcome back to Cityscape. Love conquers all. That's the theme of the latest musical offering of Tanghalang Pilipino, as it stages the popular Bicolano epic, Ibalong. Monica Magbantay gives us a sneak peek. Watch this.
For its 26th season ender, Tanghalang Pilipino brings to life the epic tale, Ibalong. A story of courage and how love conquered the conflict between a warrior and a serpent beast.
The story of Ibalong talks about actually the three warriors who invaded the land of Ibalong, which is an archaic name for Bicol. But in this version that we're going to stage, we focus more on the Handyong and Oriol, the half-serpent, half-woman monster. It's more of trying to change the landscape of Ibalong using knowledge na ang minatatapakan na pala yung humans, which is the community of the monsters. So dun umiikot yung storya niya.
Led by Miss Saigon alumna Janine Desiderio as the half-human, half-serpent Oriol, she seduces warrior Handyong, played by Mike Salomon, but in turn, falls in love with him.
It says a lot about our identity as a Filipino. Kasi pag nawala itong mga epiko na ito, which is, diba, ito yung pinagmulan ng who we are now. Kaya kailangan siyang i-share from one generation to another.
Directed by Tux Rotacio with brilliant acting from seasoned theater actors, creatively designed costumes by visual artist Leroy New, action-packed choreography by Alden Lugnasin, and live neo-ethnic music by Carol Bello and the Encantada Band, Ibalong is set to capture its audience to an audiovisual feast that celebrates the uniqueness of Filipino culture and heritage.
More theater productions, this time from Dulaang UP, a play about selling some of our national treasures to pay the country's debt. It's a gripping and intriguing story from renowned playwright Floy Quintas. Michelle Ong takes us through our country's collection.
The Chocolate Hills, the Banawe Rice Terraces, the Malolos Constitution. These are just some of the national treasures that are on sale. This is the premise of Dulaang UP's 37th season ender entitled Collection. A dark comedy from revered playwright Floy Quintas, Collection takes us to a fictional world where materialism and greed take precedence.
Collection, the play, it's set in an alternate universe where a fictional government agency called the National Council for the Disposal of Philippine Patrimony has sanctioned the sale of historical landmarks, historical objects, and the proceeds of this sale is divided up among 20 or 30,000 Filipinos. It begins with an impossible situation already. It's an auction house, Maharlika Pilipinas, and they auction off. The play opens with the auction of the Banawe Rice Terraces, five lots of the Banawe Rice Terraces. And it's really about how people, the whole play is about how people keep wanting the next big thing. Whereas we live in such an acquisitive society, we have to have the newest gadgets and newest things. So the whole play was about what if it went to that level now.
Directed by Dexter Santos, who is known for his work such as Rizal X and Zafira, his imaginative flair brings to life the various aspects of materialism and desires that are still prevalent in today's society.
I think the highlights of the play is that you have scenes that would mirror society. It's a cold, cold, hard look at the mirror. Just like what I've told you earlier, some scenes would make you think, some scenes would make you question, sometimes some scenes would entertain you, some scenes would make you laugh, some scenes would disturb you. At the end of the day, it's about a very, very special theatrical experience that you would give your audience. Yun nga, it's a roller coaster ride.
With dance as his artistic roots, he infuses vibrant and dynamic movements to the ensemble of talented theater veterans and young artists. The result? A production that does not only entertain, but disturbs and challenges certain beliefs. Dula Ang UP's collection runs until the 3rd of March, a play that offers so much more than just quality entertainment.
When we return, we go on a Pinoy food trip. We'll be right back.
Luxurious homes aren't complete without high-end entertainment systems to keep homeowners occupied. And LG Electronics has come up with something they consider to be the perfect fit for these homes. The new 84-inch ultra-high definition 3D TV is certainly one of the largest televisions in the market right now. But size isn't its only impressive quality. The resolution is 4 times higher than full HD, which translates to vivid and crisp images even when viewing from close distances. A 2D to 3D conversion engine that expands the availability of 3D content. And the speaker system that churns out rich, full sounds for a more immersive viewing experience. This massive TV was one of the main draws of the launch of Lifestyle Asia's Home and Away coffee table book.
Lifestyle Asia Home and Away is actually born out of our living section, which is a regular section that we have in the magazine, where we feature homes of various personalities in Manila society. So what we did is there's a huge following, so we compiled some of these homes, and then we went out and we shot several other new homes around the world, and also both in the Philippines. So we put together this coffee table book that's going to be available all year. It's just really like a really beautiful collection. So there are modern homes, there are old Renaissance homes, they're minimalist homes, so all sorts of homes.
It's our 26th year, and it comes on the heels of a very successful anniversary celebration where it was topped off by the winning of another award from the International Association of Business Communicators. But other than that, Lifestyle Asia espouses living at its finest. And I think every issue leads people to believe that there is something good about what we're doing. Graciousness and hospitality in a beautiful setting.
Guests mingle around the writer's bar in Raffles, Makati. And the 84-incher felt right in place amongst Manila's creme de la creme.
We're very happy to have Lifestyle Asia as partner of their events. With the launch of this 84-inch ultra high-definition TV, this is LG Electronics' response to growing consumer demand for larger, more immense 3D screens and improved picture and sound quality. We're very pleased to finally offer in the market this amazing, gigantic TV for Filipinos. Now, families can truly enjoy larger-than-life images, that pop right out of the screen, all in the comfort of one's house.
Breathtaking architecture, coupled with gorgeous interior styling and bleeding-edge technology, make up the equation for this century's ultimate dream home, something that LG and Lifestyle Asia might be able to help you build for yourself.
You're still watching Cityscape, and it's all about Pinoy Pride this week. Next is a new Pinoy restaurant that serves good old Pinoy comfort food in all shapes and sizes. And I tell you, it's definitely Num Num.
There's a new restaurant on the block that we'd love for you to try out. Num Num in Greenbelt 2 serves Pinoy dishes we grew up to.
Num Num is actually a straight-up Filipino place. It serves comfort Filipino food, like every other Filipino restaurant out there. But the menu is divided into two. You've got the left side, which is like has all the classic dishes. And then we've got the right side, which clearly states that we've taken our liberties with some of the dishes, so you're not, you get what you expect, basically.
And with a name that's a play on the word for yummy in Pinoy, I came in with really high expectations. The decor is modern and clean with neutral palette, mixed with some eye-popping colors that invites you to stay and savor your dish for as long as you want. But of course, I wasn't just here for the decor.
I'm starting off with Num Num's Pulutan. I have a small selection in front of me, and I will start off with the corned beef sisig. It's so good, guys. It has chunks of chorizo also on top, and chunks of tomatoes. Wow, the caramelized patis wings is so tarap, so yummy. I love the dip of the pinsek frito. It's actually buttered tomato alige. All of the dishes are offered in three different sizes: the small, medium, and large, like this kare-kare in front of me. Now you can order a particular dish depending on how many people are going to be enjoying it.
We've got the normal size, which is how all Filipino restaurants serve their dishes. And then we've got an extra big size, like for groups and for parties. And the most fun size is we have a small size, which is like a tapas style size. What's fun about that is that you can come and have Filipino food for different occasions. You know, now when you eat Filipino food, it's really group dining, right? And you kind of have to commit to one crispy pata and one kare-kare if you're like a table of four.
The three serving sizes aren't the only twists here. Num Num actually has an entire menu of twists, which are classic dishes with a few tweaks.
A perfect example is the kare-kare. So we have a classic kare-kare where we make our own achuete and we put in what is needed. And then on the twist side, we change the beef to lamb for one. And we played around with a nut. Instead of peanut, it's cashew. So it's not fusion. We still use ingredients and produce that you can only find in the Philippines. Like you won't find foie gras with the adobo, right? But we play around with it just a little bit. But it's still familiar flavors.
Then saladang Num Num, tinapa flakes and pomelo mix in with classic ingredients like manggat bagoong.
Now I'm really curious about the adobong bulaklak ng kalabasa. No Pinoy meal is complete without rice. Wow, the chili garlic crabs is so fresh and it's just right, and you can order in other ways.
A
as I mentioned, I came in with high expectations, and I didn't leave disappointed. The dishes were flavorful and left you wanting for more. There were enough nostalgic elements, plus some exciting flavors to keep me curious. And for once, I didn't feel like my table was set up for an entire fiesta because I could get small servings of all my favorite Pinoy staples.
I have my ube sago drink, and it's actually a dessert for me already. Oh, there's cheese on top.
Nam Nam pretty much fits the bill for whatever kind of diner you are. Whether you're a solo diner on a foodie adventure or a group who love Pinoy classics. Now let's take a trip down memory lane. The Manila Pen gives us a sample of dishes during the days of old Manila. Take a look. The old Manila restaurant at the Peninsula Manila features gorgeous and stylized interiors that remind you of the glory days of the Philippine capital. And although the restaurant usually serves fine European cuisine right alongside its Filipiniana interiors, we decided to issue a challenge to the resto chefs to whip up an exclusive menu that highlights Pinoy pride.
Filipino food, just for me, so it's fresh food, simple food. Simple food, it's not very playful. It's straightforward, therefore fresh. It's a cuisine in Asia, but as well public pleasing, unlike, for example, Chinese food, which can be very special. The Filipino food has its simplicity, which is just beautiful and very fresh.
The new challenge now with the Filipino food for us as a Filipino chef, what we did now is we call this deconstructed Filipino dish. In a simple dish, but we make that in special presentation. So, for me, that's a new challenge as a chef now because, but simple ingredients, but, you know, the result is very, gorgeous. That's the, for us as a chef.
We take a classic flavor combination and we plate it in a modern contemporary way. So as in single servings, not family style. And as we know, Filipinos are crazy about beautiful plating. And this is a challenge, yeah? To bring that Filipino family style food beautifully on the plate, and I hope you'll get it right today.
For starters, I had the baby gambas served with some spiced pineapple vinaigrette and a fern salad with some organic baguio greens. The dish was light but packed with flavor and a good play on the traditional Pinoy salads and shrimps. The appetizer certainly did its job of wetting my palate for more food. So I moved right on to the main course, the sous vide braised bukidnon wagyu beef short ribs served two ways.